You actually, in the series, you're shown as the person that reported her missing. But you actually told me that you had reported her missing before. So yeah. Can you share a little bit about that? And then what prompted you to actually report her the second time? Hello. Hi, Candice. You are muted.
No, unmute. Sorry about that.
Okay. Yeah, we are not muting anyone's voices today.
I hope
but you
not.
Know what? I can't hear you. So is it me? Oh, yeah. Okay. It was me. I had it. I had okay. volume down. Wow. Awesome. That was so weird. You were muted and I was muted. A double. Okay.
It's a Zoom meeting. So that's what happens.
Wow. Let's go ahead and get started. Hello. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Empowering True Crime. I am so excited to have Kandice Moore with us today, and welcome. Kandice was born in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and after traveling with her missionary mother, they settled in South Carolina, and she's performed in numerous theater productions and musical performances, which I've already told you I love, and I've always wanted to perform, so I'm so like a little jelly about that, sorry, but even working in the cruise industry, which is amazing. Kandice decided to pursue medicine and has her emergency medical technician license, as well as certifications in phlebotomy and TTY service for the deaf and hard of hearing. And she ended up completing her bachelor's degree in psychology. Kandice married Anthony Garcia, a U.S. soldier, and tackled the role of army wife while giving birth to their four children in just under 6 years. After suffering a head injury in an IED explosion in Baghdad, her then-spouse, Tony, was medically discharged. But things didn't get better. They got worse. After suffering from several scary domestic violence incidents at the hands of her husband, she left him in 2013 with her four kids. Since then, actually, she left with her four kids from him in 2013. Since then, she's done everything possible to support herself and her kids, starting a blog as a digital creator, and she has combined her skills to work in call centers and customer service, including in the medical industry. So welcome, Kandice.
Hi.
And Kandice was featured in the newest popular true crime docuseries on Netflix called Missing Dead or Alive. Many of you have already watched this and have shared comments with me that they love the series. And I've just gotten so many wonderful comments about the series. And your story in particular was super gripping. So Missing Dead or Alive follows investigators at the Missing Persons Unit in Richland County, Columbia, which is in South Carolina. And the show covers four missing person stories and what goes on behind the scenes as officers dive deep into the cases of persons of missing persons who have mysteriously disappeared and the crucial decisions that are made along the way. Kandice's story and that of her ex-husband, Tony, and ex-mother-in-law, Lorraine Garcia, is featured in episode 1 and 2. And it is a gripping story. I mean, it's literally, as a viewer, where it was very intense. And so walk me through a little bit. I know that, actually, let's kind of go back. Let's go back a step. I mentioned in the bio of you that you married Tony, and I know that you've shared also that he was in the docuseries, that he was like, what was your exact words? I think it was maybe not full of life, but it was something like that he was
happy-go-lucky.
Happy-go-lucky, yes.
I think that's what I said, yeah.
And then he went into the army, had this IED explosion that, you know, he suffered a head injury, and then things just went completely sideways.
Yes.
Can you share with me a little bit about how that, like, when did you really actually realize that something was really off and wrong with Tony when he came back?
When he came back, it was okay. So that there's like a lot of depth to that,
yes,
because he came back one time in the middle of the war. Mm-hmm. They gave them like a 2 week leave. And so when he came back, he didn't let anybody know he was coming back. It was the middle of the night, knocking on the door. And so I noticed then that there was a change. He just seemed a lot more on edge. A lot more vigilant, observant, even accusing me of doing things. So there was this mistrust that was there. So after that, it seemed that everything was, you know, copacetic after that visit. And then, of course, he went back and he was in the 172nd Striker Brigade. They were the ones that Donald Rumsfeld came and said, I'd love to bring them home for Christmas, but I'm not Santa Claus. Mm-hmm. So he was extended. So he should have been there for 12 months, but he ended up being there for almost 18 months. Because their unit was moved from Mosul to Baghdad. So there was a lot that happened during that transition. But when he got back, he just didn't have the same life that he used to. Everything was the war when I was over there. You know, the music even changed that he listened to, you know. So everything became about his experience over there. And then it would get into a depression, and then he would start drinking, and then he would disappear for days at a time sometimes. But my breaking point came when I would be asleep, you know, and I'm tired because we've got three babies. And he would take his SK rifle and he would basically patrol our 12 acres at night. So randomly I would be asleep and I'd hear a gunshot, you know, and for maybe an hour or two, I wouldn't know what happened, where he was, you know, did he shoot a deer? Did he shoot himself? So it was that stress on top of raising kids. And then on top of the fighting that we were doing, you know, he would get very physical with me. I had to basically cut all my hair off at one point in time, because that was his go-to, was to pull my hair. Mm-hmm. So like I was making life changes that I just shouldn't have been making. And I even took him to the VA, had him committed at the VA. No follow-up was done. It's hard to get a person to do what they're supposed to do when they don't want to do it. So I took every measure that I could have as his wife to get him help before I had to choose myself and the children or him. And so I really hate that I was pushed into that corner, you know, but there didn't seem like there was any help out there.
Yeah. And the series, it did dive a little bit into his backstory and your backstory, but mm-hmm. that's why I'm so happy that I'm talking to you, because he was definitely, I mean, it was scary. I'm not excusing his behavior by any means. But yeah. getting some more of this backstory, and you studied psychology, that we know that sometimes these events, how they can affect it. And of course, he did have PTSD. You've mentioned that. So how all of those horrific incidents that he witnessed and experienced, how that affected him, you know, but that also means, and we'll talk about this later, that they need support, right? Especially those coming back veterans and their spouses. And we'll definitely get into more of that later, because I know, I mean, this is something we've talked and I'm excited to see how that could unfold. So let's get into the docuseries with Lorraine. You actually, in the series, you're shown as the person that reported her missing, but you actually told me that you had reported her missing before. So yeah. Yes. And can you share a little bit about that? And then what prompted you to actually report her the second time?
I want to say it was around 2016. There was a hurricane that was coming. And so she said that she was, you know, concerned about the hurricane, but she didn't tell me exactly what she had planned to do. Now, a month prior, she had called me and, you know, she said that she was going to make some changes, but she didn't allude to what kind of changes she was going to make. So when Tony called me, Tony had actually gone to jail, and when he got out, he said he got back to the house and she was gone. And there was no electricity in the house. No, she cut off everything. Mm. All right. So I got concerned about her because I was like, well, she's not answering her phone. Her phone actually was disconnected. So I got concerned about her, but I did think that maybe, you know, with the things that were going on at the house with Tony, maybe she picked up and she left. So I reported her missing, and there was an officer. I basically had to drive to Columbia, put Tony in the car, and take him to the sheriff's department so that he could, you know, also report her missing. So that time I didn't just leave it up to him. I actually followed through. And they said they saw her bank records at that time, and there was a withdrawal. She was somewhere in Sumter, and then they dropped it because she was an adult, and it looked like she left willingly. She submitted, she turned in her car, she turned in her license plate at the DMV. They had video footage of her doing all of these things, so it looked like she wanted to leave that time. So we just kind of let it go to see if maybe we'd find some contact with her. And almost 2 years later, a friend of mine had a friend who knew her and said that he saw her down in Atlanta. So I followed that tip down to Atlanta. I drove down there and checked the hospitals, and one hospital basically led me to the homeless shelter she was staying in. And I met her outside the homeless shelter, and she agreed to come back to South Carolina with me. And I was living at the beach at the time. And she stayed with me for a little while, but then she went back to Tony.
Wow. And then we see, you know, so we don't even know any of this backstory. So we see this dilapidated house, all the stuff outside, the bleach, you know, carpets removed, all of this. I mean, it was a mess.
Yeah.
So she was obviously scared. She had mentioned it multiple times that she was scared of him. It was.
Well, I picked her up one time after that and brought her with me. And then she ended up going back to Tony. And every time I would pick her up, it would compromise me because now he knows where I stay. Now I got to deal with it, you know, and he's their father, my kid's father, you know, so, and I don't believe in, you know, alienating children from their dad. So if he acted like he wanted to see his kids in public places, I would allow it. You know, it wasn't a private thing. And I had this definite rule. You can't come to my house.
Sure. Got so, it. Okay.
You know, and we would meet in different places. But, you know, this last time that I picked her up, I had come up there because he said, he called me and he said, she needs help. And she's going to be alone. You should come up here with the kids and, you know, help her out. I'm not going to live in the house. I'm going to leave. Okay. So when I got to the house, it didn't look as bad as it did on the show, but it looked really, really bad. Mm-hmm. The electricity had been cut off. She was still sleeping in that front room. And she looked at me and he was there. Okay. And he had somebody in the back bedroom with them. I don't know what they were doing, but I talked to him for a minute, and then we got into an argument, and he flipped over a table or a desk, something that was in that room. He flipped it over and he got in my face and he said, don't you know I could kill you right now? And so I said, kids, let's go. And we all got in the car, and Lorraine looked at me and she said, don't leave me. So I said, come on. And I piled her in the car too, and all of her stuff, and we left. So she kept saying, I need to call him. I need to call him. This is like a week or two after she's with me. I came to North Carolina because I planned on moving into my family's own old home. And so I was up here in North Carolina, and she was like, it's just so cold up here. It's so cold up here. I'm gonna go back with Tony. So Tony came up here. We met him at the gas station. And that was the last time I saw her before I reported her missing on the show.
Okay. And about how long was that before the
maybe 6 months.
6 months. Okay.
Yeah.
And I mean, and just highlighting with domestic violence, it is a perilous situation. And so,
it doesn't end. Okay. Right. It doesn't end unless one of the parties, you know, passes away. Mm-hmm. But it's something, and especially when you have children that are connected to it, it's something that's going to be constant. And for the longest time, I really stayed away from him. I stayed away from even Lorraine sometimes. You know, it was just like, you know, that's just too toxic for me to get involved with. But then you start to get concerned about them and you still worry, you know, because you got this connection with these people. Right. So, you know, you do find that you worry, and especially in the Lorraine situation, because she's an older woman and she's their grandmother. Mm-hmm. I feel like no one else is going to look out for her, if that makes any sense, because she's pretty much in this world by herself. So I do follow up with her, which leads me to have to deal with him. But keeping my distance is something that I'm not going to be able to avoid all the time.
And so September 13th was the last time Tony in the show, Tony had seen her because he dropped her off at the hospital. When was the last time you had seen her?
I hadn't seen her since maybe March.
Okay.
Somewhere around the end of February, March.
But you spoke to her a few times.
I spoke to her on the phone. You know, he would call and he'd be like, "Mom wants to talk to you." And so he put her on the phone and I'd chit chat with her and she seemed okay. But that was maybe two or three times. And then the last time I talked to her, she was like, "I can't really talk. I don't know what they're doing. Somebody's up to something. I don't know what's happening." And I said, "Okay, well, do you want me to come get you?" "No, no, no, I'm going to be fine." You know? So I said, after probably, I think the last time I talked to her, maybe two, 3 weeks, Tony called me and said, "I took Mama to the hospital, but then when I went back to go pick her up, she wasn't there." And I said, "Okay, so are you looking for her?" And he was like, "Well, I guess." And so then he did nothing.
Right. Well, that's what I was going to ask you. Why do you think he didn't report her?
Probably thinking he's going to get in trouble for something, or he may let something slip that he's doing that he's not supposed to be doing. Just his own, I don't want to say insecurities, but his own paranoia. You know, but it's legit paranoia, because remember when I said she was missing the first time,
right?
SWAT raided her house. So that wasn't covered because of course it was a different case, but he had some dealings going on in that house, which she mentions on the show, people coming in and out.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm not sure who he was dealing with, what or why, but I'm pretty sure that was one of his reluctancies to working with the police.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things, you know, I know after rewatching it, him in, especially in the interrogation room, oh my gosh, him on the floor, him bending over. I mean, talk about body language. And you studied psychology. I mean, that's the most suspicious, you know.
Right? He really didn't help himself.
And not answering directly, answering indirectly, and all the body language.
It was married for 11 years, and I could never get a straight answer. Mm. It was always, "Hey, did you do the dishes? Why?" Why would you be asking me if I did the dishes? Did you do the dishes? And so it's simple question. And that's who he is. You know, he will turn it into something much bigger. But in his defense about his back, he was blown up with an IED and the striker, which did leave him. That's one of his disabilities.
Sure. Okay.
Is that back injury.
Right. I do know sometimes people can't. It's hard to sit for long periods of time. And who knows how long he was in there.
Yeah, he might have been there for a hot minute. Mm-hmm. So I can understand why he was doing it. But I myself found it a little comical. I was up at 3 o'clock in the morning watching it when it first came out. And I was really, really laughing. I was like, "God, I should not be laughing at this." But he wasn't doing himself any favors at
all. When you watch a lot of those interrogation rooms, there's like a voiceover kind of describing the different body language. People who put their heads down or who sleep or things like that is like, you know, textbook guilty.
Well, the thing is he was guilty of something, but not what they were accusing him of. Mm-hmm. Okay, because there was this one, the scene where he's leaned over the desk and she comes in and she says, "So who's this person trying to buy your mother's house?" And you see his shoulders just slump. It was like, oh man. You know, so he knew he was busted about something. He knew that, you know, he had a lot to cover up. So that's why he was giving that body language, I think. In the interrogation.
When people get mad, overly angry about things, right? Mm-hmm. Like some projection there and some covering up, right? Like, let's put it outward instead of focusing on me. Let's put it out. You're the one.
Trying to deflect.
You guys are accusing me.
Yeah. Trying to deflect.
Projecting out. Yeah.
But I don't think he understood that his mannerisms made him look guilty, which I think is one of the reasons they tell you get a lawyer, because lawyers will tell you, be quiet, because even your most innocent of actions can be perpetrated as something that it's not. Mm-hmm. You know, and there was a time that I did feel sorry for him because I was like, but you didn't kill your mom, you know, and because when he's like, I didn't do it, you know, I was like, man, I know you didn't do it, but what did you do?
Right.
You know, right. He leaves you thinking that something else happened.
Right.
You know?
Now, the weird part, though, is that because of his body language and how he's acting, and even outside of the interrogation room, before you know that Lorraine's okay, right? So if, spoiler alert, if anybody's watching this, Lorraine was found. But before you know that, it all leads up to you thinking that he did it, that he somehow got rid of her in some way, right? Mm-hmm. So I rewatched it, and you, like you said, that you already knew that she was okay. But rewatching it then comes to mind, it's like you said, like, obviously he knew he did something, because if he didn't kill her and he didn't, or he didn't do anything to dispose of her body or whatever, then what, why is he acting so suspicious, right? Like, what did he do?
You know, in support of the Richland County Police Department, or Sheriff's Department, they were basically getting the same dead end answers that I was getting when I was asking him, hey, did you go to the hospital? What do you mean, did I go to the hospital? Yeah, which hospital? Mm-hmm. I took her to the emergency room. So I wasn't getting straight answers from him. But then her friends were calling me and contacting me at the same time saying, you know, Tony had a tarp up in the backyard for days and they kept going out of the side of the house instead of using the front of the garage. So I was getting reports of suspicious behavior. And then when I'd start asking him questions, it was around the merry-go-round constantly. Right. It was just like, I just wasn't getting a straight answer. Mm-hmm. And I even told the producers that, no, I don't think he would have intentionally killed her. But if an accident happened, I wouldn't put it past him to try to cover it up.
Right. Yes.
So that was... That was as far as I pushed when it came to the report. I wasn't there like, yeah, he did it.
Sure, sure.
In my heart, it's like, no, he loves his mama. He's not gonna, you know, intentionally.
And he even made a comment at one point. He said something like, "I wouldn't. I don't remember the
on
word.
On purpose.
Right. On purpose.
Yeah. So on purpose.
Okay. Why would you even say that?
he's not always the most graceful with words at times. And then he kind of made it bad when he was saying she was.
Right.
And I'm like, come on,
is,
Tony.
Is. I was like, was, is. I mean,
is.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. Right. And so this, at all this point, if you're watching the show, we don't know yet about Lorraine being found. Hallelujah. Sure. Thank you. Praise the Lord. So let's get into that. So you get the story and I guess, how did you feel about, how the investigators handled the case? And then how did you feel when you found out that she was, I know that you teared up a little bit there at the end, but how did you feel, you know, anything other behind the scenes there?
I was just thrilled they took it seriously.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, the first time I felt like, oh my God, you know, she could be with anybody that's holding her hostage. They could be abusing or using her. Can we just look for her? Is there a silver alert? You know, something we can put out. She's over 60. And I just felt like enough wasn't being done, because in this country, when people go missing, the first thing the police say is, well, maybe they decided to disappear. Mm-hmm. All right. And I was just happy that they picked it up and they said, you know what? It's just too much suspicious stuff here. Let's take this and put it to the top. So hats off to them. I do appreciate them for going 100% in on the case and not letting it sit and wait.
Yeah, you mentioned the silver alert. I had forgotten about that, because we talk a lot about amber alerts for children, but we don't talk about silver alerts. So that's a really good point. Like, maybe they should put more out, you know? Mm-hmm. So is there anything that you either disagreed with the show, or maybe that didn't properly reflect your experience?
I always, like, I think about that. And the one point I want to make is that it was made to seem like I never reported any of my abuse to the police, but I did. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a serious pending case that I feel like they dropped the ball on. You know, this is one of the reasons why I'm trying to work to make the voices of domestic violence victims a lot louder. I've told my story a few times to news reporters. You know, anybody that'll listen, I will tell them what happened to me. And just to bring awareness to it, because I really feel like I was just pushed to the side and swept over and told, well, you got to suck it up, buttercup. You know, this is the way life is. And you just pick up your four kids and move on. Struggle, but move on. And no one has really, I felt like no one had really listened to me until we did the Netflix special that, you know, no one cared that this had happened to us or me or my kids. You know, the ramifications of it are so long and so crucial. But I wanted to make sure, well, I mean, I just want to be heard. I guess that's what it is. I want it out there that this is happening and for people to recognize the red flags. Also, maybe give us more support groups. You know, sister care really is all I know about when it comes to domestic violence, and they're underfunded, undersupported. Nobody really knows about them or they exist or what their purpose is. But, you know, we need more organizations like that. And I guess that's what I'm trying to vocalize at this time. So,
yes. Yeah, no, it's there's a DV hotline. But I don't even know if people know about it. At the end of this, I'm going to make sure that I include the numbers for that. But I don't think people really even know much about it. So that's a hotline to report. And there is support there. But yeah, sister care. I mean, what else? I know you were thinking about something very dear to you. We talked about it a bit ago. The veterans. And the wide spouses.
Military spouses. There are some groups that are out there. There is actually, I think it's a bill that supports divorced military spouses. But the only support that you really get from that bill is if the service member has passed or retired. Oh. So it doesn't cover enough of us out here that are dealing with disconnected service members. Veterans, war veterans. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off. You were saying.
Oh no! I was. You say asking me what was that bill?
Yes,
I
don't. Where was the bill? In what state?
No, it's a national bill.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I have to look it up again. I don't have it in front of me at the moment.
Okay. But, yes, I'll look it up as well. It's a national bill, but it only supports the spouses if the person has passed away or is retired.
Or is retired. Mm-hmm. That's the only way you can get financial support. Mm-hmm. So, but
and really, it's also more than the financial support.
I was going to say, there's also, you know, the lack of mental health support, not only for the spouses but the children. You know, because they see this, and then they experience the absenteeism of their father or their mother. You know, it can go both ways. And there's just no support for those veterans and their families. You know, there's the veteran. Yeah, they kind of support him. They give him medical, you know, they offer him mental health, but they don't offer that to the families. You know, once you're disconnected from the military, your TRICARE is no more. And now your spouse or whoever was connected has VA insurance. And depending on how long you were in, the spouse and family may also get benefits, but probably won't, because that's like a 10-year mark or so. So there's a lot of rules and regulations that are keeping people from getting the help that they need. So I'd like to shed some light on that, so that maybe we can start some groups and support groups, anything really, to get everybody seen, because it's not just the veteran, it's his entire family unit, his or her entire family unit. And that could be right down to his mom. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I cringe to know what the days and nights were like. You know, we get the gist of the whole picture, but every day is different. Every trigger is different. Every moment gets scarier. Some moments are not so scary, you know, but it's something that as a whole, I feel like needs to be addressed.
And you talk about counseling services for the individual, the military person, Mm-hmm. But even then, like that, maybe they go to a few sessions.
That's, and then they stop.
That means like, if they go.
His argument was, how is somebody going to tell me about going to war if they've never been? So he doesn't want to talk to anybody that's never been to war. So that's something that we could like bring in some of these soldiers, retrain them, offer them an education to get, you know, trained in counseling these people when they come back, you know, so that's right. Another way, you know, you could still make that soldier feel important, feel needed, you mm-hmm. know, and at the same time helping them.
Right. Yes. That's true, because you come back from war, and or the person who comes back from war, there's PTSD. Maybe they don't feel. I love how you said like feeling important, needed, you know, having a purpose, right?
Yeah.
And bills like, or the, I think I forgot what it's called, but the education bill that people come back and they can get education. I mean, that's something that can definitely be enhanced more mm-hmm. getting people. But I love the counseling angle, because. Yeah. It is. I'm actually a certified coach, and I'm best at coaching people and what I've gone through. Right.
Yeah.
I need help with children,
and I'm not about to listen to anybody that has none. That is right. Just like, you know, unless
it's a valid point. It's a valid point about having experience. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So I can understand his hesitancy, and not just his, but most of these soldiers that come back. You know, I don't want to talk to anybody that doesn't actually know what it's like to sleep on edge, to not sleep really, because you're afraid that the next whistle might be the bomb that hits your bunker. So that's something that I understand why the counseling didn't work. Mm-hmm.
And men but being more open to be vulnerable. That's not something you're taught in the military. In fact, they yeah. like make you the opposite.
Opposite of that. Yeah. Yeah, it is. I have empathy for him and a little bit of sympathy too. Mm-hmm. At the same time though, there is that accountability. I liked how when they finally charged him with selling his mom's house, she said, we got to at least hold him accountable for that. You know, mm-hmm. So there's a lot of, I guess, personal work that Tony needs to do that shouldn't be overshadowed with his needs as a veteran. You know, right. There are things that even though you bring all of this to the step and you bring all of this to the table, it's really up to him to consume it. Mm-hmm. You know, but I would have liked to have had a better support group to make him more willing to mm-hmm. consume, you know, because we were pretty much out there on our own.
So the show was filmed about 18 months ago. What has happened since? Because we didn't get an update with Tony, with Lorraine, with you. Anything you'd like to share on that front? That you can share, of course.
That I can share. Right. Yeah. I really shouldn't go and like, put his business out there. There have been some run-ins since the show that were not very pleasant, that resulted in me having to get another protection of order for me and the kids. He's going through, I guess, his own personal battles, but he has kept his distance. He figured out, of course, where I live, but I haven't had to worry about seeing him or him showing up. Even though it's always in the back of my mind that it can happen. As for me and the kids, we've just continued on. I've talked to Lorraine a couple of times, but I give her space. Okay. And I've also kind of, after this last incident, decided that it's probably best for her to be where she is and on her own and rebuilding her life. Because if we interfere in that, or even if she interferes with what we're doing now, it could really take us back instead of moving us forward. Mm-hmm. So maybe time will heal it and things will get better. I'm always an optimist. I like to see the glass half full.
Yeah. Well, it's great news that she's safe and that she's well. Mm-hmm. So that's great news, you know, because mm-hmm. a lot of times these shows sometimes get published like 2 years later. So, mm-hmm. and in this case, it was about 18
months. In this case, yeah. But wow. Yeah, she's from the last time I talked to her, she's doing great. She's getting the assistance and help that she needs. And she's, you know, not being drained by the drama. So mm-hmm. I'm happy for her with that. I want the best for her. So, you know, I just let her do her thing.
61, 62, 63. I mean, at this point, she's probably like 62. That's still young. You know, she's still got a life. She's still got a life to live.
Yeah, so, she does.
Yeah, so that's great. And like you said earlier, that people say, you know, they're an adult. They can make their own decisions as far as like in missing persons. And in this case, it sounds like she's taking control of her life. And so that's wonderful. And so we did talk a little bit about the potential of creating something with veterans and the military spouses. What would you like to see happen with that? Maybe, I know we talked maybe even, I don't want to put words in your mouth.
No, you're fine. I just, as I mentioned before, I just like to see more support. I'd like to see more options at the VA for families of veterans instead of just the veteran. And I realized that, you know, maybe the money is the option, you know, but maybe we could start a nonprofit that works with the VA that could actually see this through and give people a resource. I was thinking about it the other day. It's very difficult. People ask, why did you stay? Okay. It's very difficult to see your children and know that I'm going to have to change their schools. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have to change their daily routine. They may not even have their own bed to sleep in anymore. We may be living with other people. There's all of these thoughts that are moving through your head that says, it's not even safe for me to leave.
Right.
I'd like to find a safe place that people can call and say, I need to leave. And we'd be able to help them and assist them in the transition to make it so that it's not so traumatic on the family. Because after all, the family did serve with the veteran. We were right there with every letter, every care package, every fear that there was going to be bad news, every relocation, every move, you know, the family went through that too. So there should be some support for the family when these kind of things happen.
Right. And statistically, it's one of the most dangerous times for somebody to leave their partner, like before, during, and after. Many of the tragic cases happen during that time. And so it is. And so there's the physical harm element, safety issue, and then there's the emotional and all that component. So I would never ask somebody why they didn't leave, because it's just, there's so much that goes on, you know, at a emotional level. And then just like you said, environmentally, the schools and all of that, and your families, and, you know, it's,
You know, just, I guess, it's almost like when you're in the military and they say, hey, you're getting stationed somewhere else, you know? So it's just like that's happening, only the military or, you know, the government is not there to say, well, hey, yeah, we're going to take care of you through this move and this transition. No problem, you know, because they're not connected anymore. They're veterans, you know, and I've watched this cycle. This is not anything new. This cycle was happening with the Vietnam vets when they came back in the 60s and the 70s, even throughout the 80s when some of the war vets came back. They're kind of treated as a stigma, mm-hmm. like, oh, we know what you did, and we don't really want to mess with you, mm-hmm. you know? But that's not how we should more embrace them. You know, we have holidays for them. So
right.
We should do a lot more to care for them than what we are. And care for the families that sacrificed as well.
And as far as domestic violence, DV, what advice would you give a woman who's currently experiencing that, maybe even wants to get out of her situation?
To pack a go bag and hide it. That's what I was told when I took him. I took Tony to the VA and had him committed. And one of the counselors actually called me later and said, you really need to get out. You need to leave. And if you don't decide to leave now, at least pack a bag, have everyone's social security cards, birth certificates, any major documents that you need in one spot in a go bag and ready to leave at a moment's notice. Because my moment happened at 2 o'clock in the morning. And I left the house with no shoes on, but I had that bag and I was ready. So you may not know when you're leaving. You may not, you know, even have a plan, but have that stuff together, have it where you know where it is and you can grab it.
Wow. That's great advice for everyone. But in particular, anybody in this, I'm just thinking, I know that people in like in earthquake zones have like a to-go bag, right? Like that emergency bag. But particularly if you're having any type of spousal, because it's like we said a minute ago, it's one of the most dangerous times for spouses to leave or partners to leave an abusive partner. And so, you gotta go, and you gotta go in the middle of the night, like you did, you know, have that to-go bag ready, especially with children involved as well, right? Yeah. You just have to go.
Yeah, because the last thing you want to do is be applying for new social security cards and new birth certificates. And you honestly don't think that that's ever going to happen to you. Mm-hmm. You honestly think that you're going to be here in this house and, you know, maybe you'll have him arrested. He'll go to jail and get to stay here. But you never think of yourself having to flee in the middle of the night because the court said, well, yeah, he lives there and he can stay. Mm-hmm. So... You don't anticipate those things. You don't plan for those things. But if you're in that situation where you know you're being abused, even if it's just mentally and verbally, and you start to feel afraid, prepare for the worst. Think of it like, you know, you're escaping a natural disaster, because that's basically what it is.
Right. Yes. Wow. That's a really, that's a fascinating way to look at it. And so necessary. When I said I was going to ask you, but I didn't want to put words in your mouth, I was going to say something about legislation. I don't know, because I know we did talk about it, but we didn't really dive into if there was anything even possible or if
that. I researched it. Okay, don't ask, don't tell. One of those things where we have to research and find a true need for it with a case that reflects the true need, and then take that to legislation. But it's going to take a lot, like, probably a few months of putting stuff together before we're even ready to talk about what legislation, because they've got laws in place now that they're just ignoring. So how do you make them pay attention to the laws they're already not paying attention to? You know, because like I was mentioning to you, there's a law in the state of South Carolina, any domestic violence act comes the state versus the perpetrator. The victim does not have to press charges. So why did they let her say, I don't want to press charges? Because they're not paying attention to the law. So there's already laws there. It's just, we got to go through them and find them and figure out which ones that we can make pertinent enough to really make a change. Mm-hmm. I don't want to do anything in vain, if that makes any sense.
Of course. Yes. Mm-hmm. Should absolutely have been, it's a criminal charge. Mm-hmm. It's not a civil thing.
So no, that's a criminal charge. And then there's also the law of elder abuse. You know, that's against the law. We didn't want to think about that. I mean, and somebody mentioned to me, they said maybe it's because they don't have witnesses. There's no bruises. There's no real case they can run with. I don't care if there's no real case. Her words matter. If she said that this happened to her and then the police investigated it, we found evidence that there was probably abuse going on in the house that supports what she's saying, then that should be a case in itself. Right. It shouldn't be, does she want to press charges? No, she's a victim. She's not clear enough to be her own mental health counselor and her defense.
Sadly, it has to be almost like an extreme case for any type of physical or even sexual abuse to actually be tried. It's really pitiful. It's very, very, it's quite sad. But that's why it's so important that we create these resources so that we can prevention, red flags and all that. So I think, you know, all of that's important. So how can people contact you? Do you need support with anything that maybe you want to share now?
I think we mentioned before, I'm a digital content creator. So yes, come by Facebook, check out my reels. It's Kandice Moore. I also have a website, kandicemoore.com, where I run a small cottage business where I sell canned foods and baked goods. I also do digital photography. So I've also got some artwork, some photography artwork that I've got for sale up there. It's just a way that I make extra income while working a full-time job. And my four kids are now teenagers. Well, one is not. She'll be a teenager this year, though. She's 12. So I'm struggling with 14. I don't mean financially. I mean, sometimes, but I'm outnumbered.
Well, I love that you're an artiste. So not only do you have the musical and the theater production, then you have the photography and all the goods and all that stuff. So yeah, that's kind of like your therapy probably, I'm sure, right?
I'm not singing anywhere at the moment, but I've got my daughters that are hounding me to put together something. So I ran a karaoke business when I was in Myrtle Beach. So they're like, oh, we should do that again. So there's a few things that, you know, we'll be doing probably around Winston-Salem in the next year or so. So I will be singing again, and people can just check my website to find out when.
Amazing. So just in light of the whole show, the Netflix series and your experience, is there anything else you'd like to share or any parting thoughts?
Just that it was an amazing experience. Kudos to Blast Films. You did an amazing job at bringing these stories to light. Your production was just phenomenal, amazing. I was actually proud to be a part of this Netflix documentary for a while. We couldn't say anything other than they were filming, and for the longest, we didn't even know anything was going to be connected to Netflix. Mm-hmm. So we really thought it was just going to be like a BBC documentary. Mm-hmm. But it was just that aspect of keeping us natural, keeping us real. I've seen a lot of people say, is it fake? Is it scripted? It's definitely not scripted. It's just great work of great producers who did a beautiful job of putting our stories out there.
Wow. Well, millions of people have seen it and are feeling, you know, gripped by the stories. And so I'm so grateful that you shared your story. You know, Empowering True Crime is about giving a voice to the voiceless and not being stopped, not being muted from sharing our message and our voice. So thank you so much for sharing yours today. I really appreciate you.
Well, thank you for having me. I've actually enjoyed doing this.
Hey, wonderful. Thank you for being so candid and vulnerable. I appreciate that.
No worries, no worries. I told you, I'm not going to stop talking. So like any opportunity I have, I'm going to run my mouth. So
please don't stop the music, right?
Yes.
After listening to this video, do you feel more empowered like I do? If you enjoyed this video, let me know your favorite part in the comments and please like and share the video and make sure to subscribe so we can continue to spread more empowering news in the world. Thank you.